The wheels are turning. The mechanics are tuning. The wax is shining. The rubber is burning. The Super Chevy Show is ready for you now. Welcome once again, everyone, to our extended coverage here on ESPN2 Speed World, the Super Chevy Show, as we make our most northeasterly stop at New England Dragway in beautiful Epping, New Hampshire. The weather is perfect for the running today, mid-70s, low humidity, the sky's bright blue as you can see, and we're ready for those exciting Nitro Coupes. Burning out right now, Dave Graytek, the new car dealer from Newcastle, Delaware. His opponent will be the 1969 Camaro of Mike Stawicki. A capacity crowd on hand here today as they stage up. We're in the quarterfinal action of competition. Good green light start. Give the starting line advantage to Stawicki, who holds Graytek off all the way down the quarter mile. Give the win to the world's fastest 69 Camaro, Stawicki, 661, 213 miles per hour. Meanwhile, the Chevrolet dealer Dave Graytek had some problems. We were talking about blown cars. Well, Dave Graytek blew his in a different way. Broke the engine. Look at that big stream of oil. They'll get that cleaned up, and we'll be ready to get back underway with competition in Nitro Coupe. Our next pair coming up right now, this will be Mike Swinarski, 1968 Camaro from Hamburg, New York. His opponent will be the Western Beach-sponsored 1964 Corvette of Mike Castellana. Now, Castellana formerly ran a Camaro, switched over to the more popular and more aerodynamic Corvette, as we take a good look right there at Mike Swinarski backing up into our ESPN2 cameras. Beautifully turned out Nitro Coupes. These cars are like IHRA Pro Modifieds, except they don't run just alcohol. They run 30% nitro methane, an idea conceived by Roger Gustin, who owns AutoStar, the people that put on the Super Chevy shows. Swinarski 688, as there was problems for Castellana. Take a look back on the starting line. We'll try and see exactly what happened there. Ah, yeah, that tells it all right there. As you saw that puff of fire out the header, Castellana was done in the Corvette. Stage car up, couldn't go anywhere. Here comes the man. This is Mel Eves, who bounced back from a horrendous wreck earlier in the season. His opponent will be the Summit-sponsored 1968 Corvette of Bill Kuhlman, the first man to break the 200-mile-per-hour barrier in a full-bodied car. Did that about 10 years ago. Mel Eves, on the other hand, with that Mega Power-sponsored later model Camaro that used to belong to Bill Kuhlman out of Wentzville, Missouri. Kuhlman sold the car to Mel after he totaled his 57 Chevrolet in Memphis, Tennessee. Now they've become kind of semi-teammates. They'll be racing each other. Staging very carefully. It'll all be over in 6 seconds. Well, Kuhlman ends it on the starting line, turns on the foul start light. We'll look at that again in a moment. Mel Eves, 629, 219 miles per hour, as the insurance man makes a positive statement. An incredible ET. Let's look at that red light start. No doubt about it. Bill Kuhlman with the Corvette out first, turned on the red light. Meanwhile, Mel Eves lays down an unbelievable time, and is his crew ever celebrating. All-time best ever for Mel Eves. No one has been in the 20s this weekend thus far, that is. But here comes a guy who can change all of that. He'll be getting the bye run because he was the number one qualifier. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the team of Fred Hahn and Jim Hottie. Hahn doing the driving chores in their Synergy-sponsored 1937 Chevrolet. Look at this car run. 657, 213 miles per hour. So he is 2 or 3 tenths off of that pace set by Mel Eves. This Speed World coverage is being brought to you by Summit Racing Equipment, 30 years of low prices and expert advice, and by Precision Gear. When your rear end is on the line, depend on Precision Gear. Welcome back to New England Dragway as we continue our coverage of the Super Chevy Show. A little more of the show action going there. You're looking at Danny Berman's chuck wagon wheel stander. Ever wonder why it's called a wheel stander? Pretty obvious, was it? Now, part of the other attraction that is at every Super Chevy Show as we travel across the United States are the jet cars. You're looking right now inside of John Simmons and the Southern Flame. It's a real unusual jet car. Matter of fact, it's not a car. It's an S10 Chevrolet pickup truck. You're hearing the motor spin that jet engine over right now as he'll breathe life into it. Most of these modern-day jet drag vehicles are propelled by Pratt and Whitney jet engines or GE jet engines. You're looking inside the funny car owned by Roger Gustin, driven right now by Jerry Gannon, sponsored by the Automotive Shopping Network. Now, they'll let both of them idle, and they'll begin what's called the firefight. They have afterburners, just like jet fighter planes. You see the afterburner being engaged right there. Quite a show put on for the fans as they begin to warm everything up. They'll start popping, doing what they call burner pop, afterburner pop. The crowd absolutely loves these jet cars. Believe it or not, they'll go well over 200 miles per hour in the quarter mile. Gannon having a problem right now. Looks like he's shutting down the car. John Simmons, meanwhile, ready to go in the Southern Flame jet pickup truck. Gannon trying to shut the car off, and you can see he has a fire that I think is out of control right there. Meanwhile, John Simmons will run down the quarter mile at 6 seconds flat, 249 miles per hour, but no one's watching that. All eyes are on the starting line right now as they cannot get the jet engine on Jerry Gannon's car shut down. Phil Gustin, the crew chief right now, conferring with Jerry as he gets out of the car, and that flame still coming out of the afterburner tailpipe section of that jet engine. Now they're using a fire extinguisher on it, trying to put it out. The engine has been shut off. The engine is no longer running. The crowd cheers its approval as they thought they had it out. Now they're going to hit it again. This jet engine, ladies and gentlemen, will not stop running. It's the kind you want to have on an airplane, believe me. Smoke still coming from that tailpipe of that jet engine. They'll hit it again with the fire extinguisher. The people at New England Dragway are to be congratulated here as they have a lot of firefighting equipment on hand. And you can see there is still a flame in the afterburner of that jet engine. The firemen standing by, attired there in fireproof clothing, ready to fight a fire. Here comes Roger Gustin, the owner of the car, the promoter of the Super Chevy shows. He's indicating, I believe, that they're going to try spinning the motor over. Now, a lot of times, what that will do is literally blow the fire out. You see the motor being spun over right there. Fire is sucked back up inside the engine. Now they're literally blowing the fire out by spinning the motor over. It looks like it may have worked. It did indeed, as Jerry Gannon is out of the car, out of his fire suit and his driver's uniform and everything. And while they push the car off, let's take a study and get to know Jerry Gannon a little bit better as we go to Profile, a study of the cars and stars that compete on the Super Chevy circuit. Brought to you by Precision Gear. When your rear end is on the line, depend on Precision Gear. Now here's Ken Stout.
The normal transition to become a professional racer is to start off, well, let's say in a street car, and then, of course, you would progress up in racing categories quicker and faster as the years go by. Most professional racers have been doing it, I'd say, a minimum of 10 years, some 15, 20, maybe even 30 years of racing. Well, in this case, it's just a little bit different.
Jerry, you really have kind of a unique story. You really didn't do much drag racing up till just a few years ago.
Right, I hired in with Roger Gustin, and it was back in 89 it was the first year, and I started driving in 91.
So how did you get started? I mean, you never was in a previous drag car, say, back in the 70s?
No, I just hung out with Roger there a few years, and he showed me everything about the car, and I jumped in it and got my license.
How did the situation come about where you actually joined the team?
That's when Roger had a bad car wreck and I was going to hire another driver. And I said, I'd like to have a try at it.
You'd like to take a crack at it, climb in there and see what it feels like anyways, huh?
Exactly, yeah. Roger says, you mean you'd like to drive the car after all the things you've seen happen through the years? I said, well, yes, I'd like to try it. So we went, rented a track and was licensed a few days later.
So how was that learning curve? I mean, it must have been pretty steep to climb inside of a car after never racing anything.
Well, it sort of came easy. You know, like I say, I knew everything about the car, how to start it, and that's the hardest part, really, about a jet engine is starting the car. And went down the track with, like, 8-mile runs, and it felt really good. So just build it up, you know, go up 1,000 foot. So I did. And the third day, it finally took the third day before I could get the quarter mile.
So in the third day, after how many runs did you finally go the quarter mile?
I stayed in the car for 2 days.
For 2 days. So you made a fair amount of runs.
Oh, lots of runs. Yeah, probably 20 runs a day.
You actually learned this car inside and out.
Exactly. I worked on the car for 3 years and still work on the car and drive and truck driver also.
So a little bit of everything, a man of many hats.
Oh, yeah, lots of hats.
Jerry certainly located a very, very good ride, picking up where Roger Gustin left off. Of course, the Gustin legacy is a mile long. He's done it for a long time. He's got great equipment, great carrier, great crew, and he's very, very fresh. Think about it. He's only been doing this for 4 years. He's like a little kid just getting started. He's not going anywhere, and he wants to go quick and go fast for a long, long time.
Thank you very much, Ken. We'll take a short break from the action, and when we return, we'll have semifinal round of the Nitro Coupes. Welcome back to New England Dragway as the capacity crowd is ready for the semifinal round action of Nitro Coupes. Meanwhile, Ken Stout went down to see exactly what happened with that jet fire.
Caught up with Phil Gustin over here in the pits, of course, one of the wrenches here for Jerry Gannon. And the jet car, what went wrong at the starting line? Well, from what we understand, it appears to be relatively simple. The fuel tank runs under pressure. They air this up initially. You can see the valve stem on top of the inlet cap. And then after the car is started, the compressor sends about 40 pounds of air into the tank. It needs to stay at 40 pounds. There's a regulator in the line. Apparently, the regulator has gone bad. When they checked it, it had no pressure at all. Then the problems just compounded. When Jerry reached over to turn the car off, he pulled back the chute handle. When you pull the chute handle back, it pulls the engine handle back to shut off the engine and also turn off the burner. Well, the burner was left on just a little bit, and it dumped some raw fuel into the hot section of the motor. Thus force, raw fuel, a lot of heat, and it ignited. A lot of raw flame out of the back of the motor, quite possibly hurt the hot section. $10,000 if you want a new one.
Whoa, all right. Who said jets were cheap to race? $10,000 for a new hot section. Give me two. Ready to go. Semi-final round action of Nitro Coupes right now. This will be Freddie Hahn against Mike Stawicki. You can see how they advanced out into the semi-final round. Mel Eves will face Winarski next. Right now, though, our attention is on Mike Stawicki with that 69 Camaro against Freddie Hahn in Jim Oddie's car. Good green light start for both racers. Good reaction times. Give the advantage to Hahn with a 418. He had problems, though. Stawicki, 682, not real impressive. 202 miles per hour. Probably saw with his peripheral vision there problems over there for Hahn, who just went into violent tire shake and was forced to shut down. Here comes Mike Swinarski, the 1968 Camaro out of Hamburg, New York. His opponent will be Mel Eves, the guy that laid down that impressive 629. While they're staging up, we'll take time for the performance tip. Professional tips on the latest performance technology available. Items featured on the performance tip are available from Summit Racing Equipment, 30 years of low prices and expert advice.
I'm standing here with the Blue Ball Racing Team Citation, and what's unique about this car is the quickest Citation in the world. One of the reasons, first of all, I noticed is this monster motor. I'm Bill Kuhlman with this week's Summit Racing Equipment Performance Tip. This motor has the famous NOS nitrous oxide system, which no doubt is a big reason for the high power. But I've spotted a way we can make this car go even faster. And what I'm holding in my hand is the answer to that. It's the Pro Race latest solenoid from NOS. What guys do in general, they go inside these solenoids and they try and hog them out and make them larger. But what they don't realize is one of the bigger problems in the solenoid is getting things past the plunger. The plunger just doesn't lift high enough for the flow to go past. NOS has taken care of that in this solenoid. This is a high lift plunger. They also have straightened out the orifice by a bottom outlet. So you can have the latest nitrous oxide system on your car, but if you want to update it, make it even quicker, look to NOS. That's where I've always looked.
All right, thank you, Bill. You want to hear a little piece of irony? Bill Kuhlman is doing the tuning on Melly's car. Mel just beat Bill to race Mike Swinarski. Let's see if Bill's tune-up still works. Oh, no race here, folks. Melly's 641. 217, looks like he may have hurt the car. Little puff of smoke right there. I'm sure Kuhlman will be right on top of it. You're looking at one of the Chevrolet concept cars here at the Super Chevy Show. Just part of what makes up a Super Chevy Show, but we're more concerned with what's going on the drag strip on this particular Speed World program, including Junior Dragsters. To find out more about them, let's check in with Ken Stout.
The face of drag racing has changed forever, courtesy of a gentleman by the name of Vincent Knapp and his son, David Knapp. Of course, Vince owns Old Bridge Township Raceway Park in Englishtown, New Jersey. They built the first ever junior dragster, and this category has grown immensely. It is now very, very large all over the country. In fact, they even have a national event each year in Indianapolis. They run in the divisional meets, and these kids are awesome. They're used to going off the bottom bulb, and when they step up out of the junior dragster ranks, they are killers. They take their fathers out. They take veteran racers out that have been doing it for 10, 15, 20 years. Their lights, 5-teens and 5-20s on a regular basis. They have ice water running through their veins. They are afraid of nothing. They have no fear. We found one of these guys. We talked to him, and you'll see that they're very, very cool, calm, and collect. It's just another day in the park. And you race in conjunction with your brother, correct?
Yep, yep. He races first year for him. He's doing pretty good. Yeah.
They have a couple different age brackets?
Yeah, there's 8, 9-year-olds and 10 and up to 17.
Now, how quick is your car?
My car goes in the eighth mile, 10 seconds at 64 miles an hour.
64 miles an hour, and you're how old again?
11.
That is flying. Now, how quick is your brother's car?
He goes 1290 in the eighth mile at around 50 miles an hour.
And how old is he?
He's 9. Just turned 9.
Now, have you ever raced your brother?
Yes, I raced him 3 times last year, and I won all of them against him.
So you're beating up on your little brother.
Yep.
Your day's probably coming. He probably wants to get even, right?
Yeah, probably right.
So what do you hope to drive when you grow older?
Probably super comp dragster.
These kids have no problem with it at all. Boys and girls alike, they are killers in this category. Well, we see them on camera. They look pretty docile. A little boy, little girl, right? Put them inside the car, the animal comes out. You seen those stickers that say, fear this and no fear? Well, Scotty has the same. He painted it on the front of his helmet. It says, fear me.
All right, kid. Two of them staged up now as we go into the semifinal round. Justin Mason over there in the far lane. Mike Stefari from Tewksbury, Massachusetts in the near lane. Mason, age 12, Stefari, age 14. One of the higher categories. They class these cars by age group. Justin Mason picks up the win, 989 on a 980 dial-in. And our other semifinal pairing will find Amanda LaChapelle, age 10, from Marlboro, Massachusetts, against Steve Benoit. He's also 10 years of age, out of Montpelier, Vermont. They race an eighth mile, 660 feet. To hold the speed down, and look at that, he still runs 64 miles per hour. Benoit will go into the finals. We'll have that for you later on. This Speed World coverage is brought to you by Original Parts Group, world's largest source of GMA body parts and accessories, and Lone Star Muscle Car, your GM weather stripping and interior specialist. Call for a free catalog. Back in Epping, New Hampshire at the Super Chevy Show, the crowd is having a ball, courtesy of this lady as she throws footballs into the crowd. Meanwhile, we have problems down in the Nitro Coupe pit.
Mel Eaves made his quickest and third quickest pass ever this weekend in Epping, New Hampshire. A 7.29, very respectable, I might add, and a 7.41. Unfortunately, on both passes, he hurt a piston. First time, well, they had a spare bullet. They changed it for the backup motor end. Second time, no more spares. Not only did he hurt the piston, as you can see here, he killed the sleeve and the head. One man's bad luck is another man's good luck. Mike Swinarski will make it to the finals because Mel Eaves cannot make the call.
All right, Ken, thank you very much. The break rule here at Super Chevy. Meanwhile, we're ready for the finals here. Justin Mason will be taking on Steve Benoit. And we'll give the win right there as they approach the eighth mile in the junior dragster competition to Justin Mason. The 12-year-old runs a 9.90. Dad weighs his approval. Ken Stout is with our winner.
Justin, you took the little guy out. You beat him on both ends of the track. A better reaction time and a better number.
Yeah, but I thought he was going to get me on the line, and his car's been, like, running pretty close to dialing, so I had to dial my car, in, like, real close to what I just ran because I knew he'd run real close.
Steve, you kept the pressure on him, but you let off a little bit at the end. You didn't run the number, and he got away from you, huh?
Yep. I'm just saying thanks for letting me use his motor. Got me a final round.
Got you into the final round. Congratulations, Justin. You did a great job, man.
Thanks.
Hey, Ted, what do kids do when they're not racing junior dragsters? Well, they sit inside and they play video games. What else?
That is when they're not watching ESPN2. Time for the original choice, which highlights cars that are all original or restored to original showroom condition. Brought to you by Original Parts Group. Here's Don Garlitz.
Prior to World War II, in my humble opinion, one of the most beautiful cars that was ever built was the 1940 Chevrolet Coupe. This is Joel Kimball's 40 Coupe, and this is a business coupe, meaning that it does not have a seat, little opera seats behind the passenger seats. If it did, it would be called a club coupe. This car is just loaded with accessories that were available in 1940, some of which I had never heard of. One being, here is a thermometer, outside thermometer for the air in the rear view mirror. You can see it right there. You look out the window, you see what the temperature is. The car also has the original 40 radio, it has original 40 heater, and it has 40 turn signals, a very, very rare accessory. Car has been left entirely stock. Joel is very proud of this little jewel, and it's a daily driver, and it's my original pick of the week.
Well, I can see why, Big Daddy, and I agree with it. Ready for the Nitro Coupes final. Near lane Mike Swinarski, far lane Mike Stowicki. The Mikes, both in a pair of Camaros, going at it. Oh, this is going to be tight all the way down to the finish line. Give it to Mike Stowicki. 6.76 to a losing, get this, 6.75. He won it with a 4.64 hole shot by less than a car length.
Congratulations, man. 6.76, 2.15. Maybe not the best run of the weekend, but it was certainly good enough to get you a win.
Yes, it was. And great day for G-Force race cars. We have two cars that were in the final, and this thing shakes and shimmies. And it was terrible all the way down, but we made it here. It's great.
And that will bring to a close this coverage of the Super Chevy Show from Epping, New Hampshire. We leave you with the B.F. Goodrich Exhibition Car. For Big Daddy Don Garlitz and Ken Stout, this is Ted Jones. So long, everyone.